The Chrysalids by John Wyndham. Dramatized for radio by Barbara Clegg. With Stephen Garlick as David.
The city is going to sleep.
Good night, David. David, my darling. Sweet dreams until the morning.
Until morning. Dreams. Strange to think that once I only saw the city in my dreams. Even when I was quite small, it seemed real to me. Real enough to try to describe it to my sister.
There are boats there too, Mary.
Boats?
Yes, in the harbour.
You've never even seen a boat, so how do you know that's what they are? You've never even seen the sea, if it comes to that.
I have.
When?
In my dream. It's blue and it's big.
Seen it properly, I mean. Awake. I don't suppose the real sea's like that at all.
It's bigger than... Well, it's not like anything I've ever seen.
You can't dream about something you've never seen. Oh, you're making it up.
The buildings aren't a bit like ours either. And the traffic in the streets is strange.
What do you mean?
There are carts running with no horses to pull them. And sometimes there are things in the sky.
Birds, you mean?
No! Shiny, fish-shaped things. And when I dream, it's night time there. There are lights, like glowworms, but very bright. All along the shore and drifting in the air.
I don't think I want to hear any more.
Oh, but it's beautiful, Mary. Where do you think it is?
Nowhere. There's no such place, not any more. You must be dreaming about the world the way it used to be, in the time of the old people, before God sent tribulation.
It must have been a wonderful world.
Yes. David?
Hmm?
I wouldn't mention it to anyone else if I were you.
What?
This dream you keep having.
Why not?
Well, I don't think other people have pictures in their heads like that. They might think it was odd.
Like me being left-handed, you mean?
No. Being left-handed doesn't really matter. That's all right.
Everything was all right, of course. Or so it seemed to me at 10 years old. I was a happy, carefree boy, and took my world for granted. The high bank was just a part of it, coming round in a wide curve and running straight as an arrow to the distant hills. I never thought of it as man-made then. It seemed too vast to be a work, even of the wondrous old people. But the day I crossed that barrier, I also crossed another. It was that day, exploring the other side, that doubt first entered my world. That day, I met Sophie.
Who's there?
Hello.
Who are you?
I've been watching you sliding down the bank.
I've never seen you before. I thought I knew everyone round here.
It does look fun.
Would you like to have a go?
Yes! Yes, I would!
Okay.
Of course she would. She was Sophie. Not like any girl I'd met before. Gaiman and lots of boys I knew. And she could stick at things too.
I've nearly had enough.
I haven't! Wait!
Well, hurry up. Hey, I'm waiting for my turn. Move over.
I can't. It hurts.
What's the matter?
My foot's stuck.
Let's see. It's jammed between two stones. Oh, it's no good. I can't budge them. Try and sort of twist your foot out.
Well, come.
Wait a minute, I've got a knife.
What's that for?
To cut the shoelace. I can't get at the knot.
I mustn't take my shoe off.
Why not? Look, if you don't take your shoe off, you'll be stuck here forever. You'll probably die here.
All right. But you mustn't look.
Oh, I can't help but look, can I? Ooh, it's a bit puffy. It's swelling like anything. Oh.
Poor Sophie. She couldn't walk. She couldn't even put her shoe on. And all she wanted was to get home.
It's all right, Sophie. Sophie!
I'm sorry, Mummy!
Oh, your knees.
I carried her as far as I could.
I had to crawl.
They're all bleeding and... And your foot, Sophie. Come inside.
Warmth. The Wenders' home was filled with it. Different from mine in every way. Much smaller. No texts hanging on the walls, and no disapproval.
There. Now, pat it dry and kiss it better. And now, the bandage, please, David.
Here you are.
And when we've made it more comfortable, we're all going to have something to eat. And then you, my poppet, are going to hop up to bed.
I'll have to, because I can't walk.
Come on.
And that was how it was all through the meal. We never laughed at meal times at home. It was like a revelation to me that people could be so relaxed together. But after Mrs. Wender had carried Sophie up to bed, she came down and sat beside me, and she was much more serious then.
You're a good boy, David. Thank you for being so kind to Sophie.
She was very brave. It must have hurt like anything.
You saw her foot?
Yes.
Did it seem odd to you?
You mean because it's got an extra toe?
Yes. You are the only person who knows, except for her father and me. Nobody else must. Ever. That's very, very important.
Why?
Because if anyone were to find out, they'd be terribly unkind to her.
Sophie?
Yes.
Because she's got six toes?
Yes. So, we've got to keep it a secret. You promise, David?
I promise.
I was halfway home before any connection dawned on me. The connection, that is, between Sophie's toe and the precepts which were dinned into us every Sunday, including the definition of man.
And each leg shall be jointed twice, and have one foot, and each foot five toes, and each toe shall end with a flat nail. And any creature that shall seem to be human, but is not formed thus, is not human. It is a blasphemy against the image of God, and hateful in the sight of God. Hateful in the sight of God!
God can't hate Sophie. Not because of one little toe. Oh, I expect I've got it wrong.
I used to go over to Sophie's home once or twice a week after that. I met her father, John Wender.
So, you're David.
Yes.
Joseph Storm's boy. Your father's a man of consequence, lad. Waknut Farm, a magistrate, a preacher.
Yes.
And more than that... He's a very pious man, isn't he? With a keen eye for a deviation. So you'll know what an offence is, eh, lad?
An offence. I used to think it quite exciting when an offence was found amongst the farm stock. First it would throw my father into a furious temper. Then, in the evening, he would call us all together to pray.
The penance of tribulation was put upon the world for sin. As the expulsion from Eden, as the flood, as the pestilences, as the destruction of the cities of the plain, as the captivity, so was tribulation. And the duty and purpose of man in this world is to fight against those evils which tribulation loosed upon us.
Next morning, we'd all be up before daylight and gather in the yard.
Rejoice, rejoice, true purity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.